Welcome into Southside Pod. My name is Chris Lanuti, bellying up to my 9-foot homemade oak bar. Pour yourself a cold one as we sit in the basement on the south side of Chicago and cover everything in the area that matters most to you. Now, if you are new to Southside Pod, let me tell you what you're going to hear. 30 minutes of good for Southsiders by Southsiders. First of all, my friends, Bill at the end of the bar. Hannah's here to help us out as well and go out and do some restaurant reviews. And whenever you hear a guy playing the acoustic guitar, that is Acoustic Mike. Plus a cast of characters popping in to bring you everything Southside that we possibly can each and every week. And there's already shows on demand. Go back and listen to them. You can find them on every single podcast player. We are now on Spotify, Google Podcast, Apple Podcast. I think you can say Alexa, play Southside Pod. If not now, soon. Tell your friends, subscribe, don't miss an episode. On this program, we have a doctor from the area, many of you may go to already, who's going to give you the plain truth about COVID vaccinations, what you should expect, who should get them now, and also those in his own family that will not be getting them. We're going to take a trip to America's Dog and Burger, AD&B, and taste some incredible variations on hot dogs and hamburgers. But before we get to anything, sitting down here at the 9-foot homemade oak bar, good friend of mine from Open Outcry at 109th and Western, a great brewery. Go check them out. In fact, they have a podcast dome. It's like a special room up on the top on their roof. You can actually go and reserve, and we set up the entire thing. It's even got a working microphone inside of it. It's absolutely awesome. John Brand down here at the bar. How are you, buddy?
Hey, buddy. Happy New Year. Nice to see you.
It's good to see you. I want to talk about this beer that you brought by, but I also want to introduce your friend that's down here. Dan McCabe is sitting down here, and you have your own pottery studio, from what I understand. These two guys are friends. You know what's funny is that they've been giggling ever since they sat down at the bar. They've already started drinking. John has downed his first pint, and he's ready for another one. Like, it's going to be a good interview.
A pitcher of beer, a pitcher of beer. Let's order another pitcher of beer. That pitcher of beer should come over here. I love that pitcher of beer.
A Saison with cranberry. It's 7.5% from Open Outcry. And John, where does this beer idea come from? Tell us what a Saison is, first
of all. Yeah, I've never heard of Saison.
Not everybody knows what it is.
All right, so Hannah, yes. I love educating you on beer.
Yes, I've learned a lot about beer.
Look how he immediately goes, forget Chris, I want to educate Hannah.
Because you probably know already.
All right, so a Saison. A Saison is a traditional, the roots of a Saison are traced back to France. Okay, so it's a French farmhouse beer. The yeast is a little bit more wild. You get a little bit more sour notes in this thing. But it was traditionally brewed in France in the winter. And it was usually ready like in the spring and in the summer. And it became a beer of the French working class. In fact, folks that work in fields in France, they would brew this in the winter. And then after a day out in the fields or a day working, this was a beer that was consumed by the French working class. In this country, it's kind of I would say that it's a style right now that hasn't necessarily caught on too much with craft drinkers. Folks that were part of the first craft wave, like maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago, were getting into Saisons, but it's kind of been left out in the latest wave of styles. Will Turner, our head brewer, is a huge fan of Saisons. He's been brewing them for almost 30 years. This is a beer that he's been brewing for about that time. This Saison used traditional French Saison yeast, and what's fun about this particular version, by the way, the beer is called the Standard Deviation.
Okay.
It's the second time we've done it. The first
I didn't give you the beer name. I just went with the style. Sorry about that.
The first time we did it, we also put fresh tangerine in the beer. We didn't do that. That was a great beer, but we were able to get our hands on some fresh cranberry. So this is a French Saison with fresh cranberry, 7.5%. And when you drink it, if you're familiar with this style, you'll say that, yep, this is a French Saison.
Now, I've had Saisons before, and you're right. The first wave of craft beer, that was something that used to pop up. I used to have them down here in the fridge. But what's funny is, I would always buy them in the summer. I think it's kind of funny you point out that this is a winter drink in France, because I was like, Saisons are lighter to me.
Well, it was brewed in the colder months.
Okay.
And then fermented, and then was ready in the spring when it started to warm up. So when guys were out in the field working, this became the beer of the French working man.
I like it.
In the spring.
You know what I feel like about fruity beers, and yet I would drink this. So you always win me over with that, because you don't overpower on the fruit.
And that's been our MO since the beginning, and Will Turner's brewing style. We do not go too heavy, or we do not go too aggressive with the fruit. Fruit in our beers typically is complementary and subtle, and that's the
this
was
very subtle.
This.
It's very good. It's not too tart. You think when you hear cranberry, it's going to be like real tart, and it's not. It's real smooth.
The,
it's the not
tartness
really
and the cranberry will complement the spicy clove, borderline. I don't want to use the word sour, but those notes that you typically get in a saison. I think that tartness and the cranberry really complements what saison yeast does to a beer.
Well, you know, I would never think I like this kind of beer, but I'm going to sit here and enjoy the tartness. There's a lot of show ahead. John Brand over at Open Outcry, 109th and Western Avenue. Check them out. Wild Bill has been anxiously awaiting, though, the premiere of a song. Acoustic mic playing. Wild Bill on the microphone. And according to my notes, this is an ode to the greatest actor alive. I don't know what this is, but it's here on Southside Pod. God help us all.
Sitting at home and feeling groovy. I think I want to pop in a movie, yeah. Don't know what I want to watch yet. Oh, no, no, no. Flipping through all my Blu-rays. Seeing lots and lots of movies. And they all have the same actor. Yeah, he must be my most favorite actor guy. Every movie is in its left to buy. The way he moves in every scene, I just want to see him on the big screen. Danny DeVito, he is a little bald Italian short fat man. He even played the little villain in Batman. You know, a little guy from Texas, yeah, that man. Danny DeVito, a comedian that's really funny. Season 2 of Up, It's Always Sunny. Yeah, his movies laid lots of money. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. He played Schwarzenegger's twin, which was crazy. And also the one where Arnold had a baby. He romanced the stone back in the 80s. Danny DeVito acted in Throw Mama from the Train. The War of Roses was so insane. He impresses me again and again and again. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. My favorite actor is Danny DeVito. Yes, he's very, very poquito. But Rhea Perlman thought he was bonito. Then they got a divorce and were finito. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. He's a little bald Italian short fat man. He even played the villain Penguin in Batman. You know that little guy from Texas, yeah, that man. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito.
You know, Bill, we were talking about this, I think, on a more recent episode, the difficulty going out to find something to eat. And, you know, John Brand, Open Outcry, he not only has a brewery, but he's got a brew pub. You can eat in there. And he's had to go through all these different things with the restrictions getting tightened and loosened and tightened and loosened and just trying to stay alive. We're going to talk with America's Dog and Burger here in just a moment. Same problems for them. But we're also going to have a doctor on here in just moments who's going to talk about the vaccinations, what's safe and what isn't safe. It is a fine line, but the good news is things are loosening. Vaccines out. IHSA just announced there's going to be high school sports again, but it's probably not opening up quick enough for all these guys. That's why you got to support them. Because trust me, no matter how they're doing it, I support a business owner, especially a restaurant or bar owner that stays open, but I'm still trying to do it safely.
Right.
I do.
Thank you.
I respect that because that's not,
That's not, I'm thumbing my nose at this and I don't really care about it. That is,
they're making an effort.
I'm making an effort to do the best
I
can.
And that's all I'm looking for.
When technically, if I'm going to get fined, I might as well just open the whole thing up. And
if a guy walks in without a mask, I'm not going to tell him to leave, but I'm going to ask him politely, maybe to.
Can you possibly throw one on until you get to the table? Right. Something
like
that.
I'm not going to be a dictator, but I'm going to try to, I'm not going to use the word comply because I hate it, but. I'm going to try to, again, make an effort. That's all it comes down to. And I appreciate any business owner that does that.
Just like you deal with, I think that it's the most South Side thing is how you should deal with this pandemic. Just don't judge people.
That's impossible.
Fine. Judge people.
Judge away.
Judge away. In fact, the most South Side thing is the judge.
Yeah, right.
Like to be like, guy's a jag. Exactly. Judge away, but
silently maybe. If you want to be,
but
cordial.
you try to do right, right? You know when you're being a jag, and you know when somebody's being a jag to you.
Right.
That's the kind of the way of this entire area. There should be South Side rules for the pandemic. That are different from the rest of the
when
state.
When you're jagging somebody, you know you're jagging them, and they know they're
being jagged around.
Right.
I jagged somebody around the other day. I'll tell you the story.
All right.
I put in an advertisement for one of my other podcasts. I was able to buy the ad that's on the back page of the book.
Okay.
So it's like the most primo spot to get.
Sure, right.
And I get an email from the person after I sent him the artwork. Now, the artwork that I sent was designed by somebody I know who's been doing advertising for decades. And the person writes me the thing, and this is just the person that takes the ads and puts them in the book.
Okay.
And they tell me they don't like my ad.
What?
They're like, nah, for nothing.
Wait, they just don't like it personally?
But the guy, cartoon character you have in the ad looks like a doofus, and I don't like it. That was the email I got.
So it wasn't against their guidelines. It wasn't against their code of conduct or anything. It was just a personal guy just didn't like it.
Personally didn't like the ad. And I'm like, so I wrote back. I'm like, all right, I'm sorry you don't like it. This is why we did it. We think it's eye-catching. We get a good response. We've been using it for about 2 years, and I'm just explaining it, right? She writes back and she goes, and her first line that she writes to me is, just so you know, I have 30 years of experience printing books. You know, I could print books for 30 years. And
I have 43 years of judging a-holes.
She writes like this whole thing with like her entire resume. And then at the end of it goes, so me personally, I think it's stupid. But if you'd like me to get you in contact with somebody. So this is when I did the classic Southside jag.
Okay.
Like you can write back F you, right?
Sure.
Like the first thing you're thinking is
that's the easy route.
Go F yourself.
But like, the Southside way is.
Print the ad. But instead I just wrote her name with a little comma. And I was like, I really appreciate your feedback.
That alone is really aggressive.
It's a really.
It shouldn't be, but it is.
It is.
It's like when someone's like being jerked to you, you go, Doug, comma. Like, it is just the worst.
Now the jagging begins where I go, I really appreciate your feedback.
Even worse.
It's a total jag move, right?
Because they know.
Right, they know.
You don't.
Oh, this is the Southside jag right here. That's what this is. So now.
Thank you so much.
So now I write, and she had written like her thing. I have 30 years of experience in this. And I go, the ad was made by a good friend of mine who owns his own company and has 25 years of experience in advertising.
Five less than her.
Yeah. It's five less than hers,
yeah.
But she prints, he comes up with ads.
Oh, okay.
And I'm just throwing out, you want to give out decades, I'm going to throw decades back at you. That was a total jag move as well, right? And I'm like, but I'm always open to new ideas.
It would be funny if you're just doing like random decade things. Like, he was just like.
He has 87 years of experience.
Kristen, comma. Led Zeppelin has been making albums for 70 years.
It's nothing to comma. Do. It has nothing to do with the conversation.
The War of 1812 has been over for 181. just random.
Good
years.
Guess. That was a good guess. You were close on that, but not actually close.
Anyway.
Okay.
It's the middle of the show song. 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 Chris had nothing to put here, so he put this song. It's the middle of the show song.
You know, my mom and dad, they're both over 65. They're waiting patiently for their chance to get the vaccine. And Dad's like, stick me twice, I'm ready. Like, he has no fears over this thing. He's like, if there's long-term effects, if it messes you up like 30 years down the line, I'll be dead by then. I just want to go out and have a beer and not have to worry about it. And I get that. It makes sense to me. Mom's like, don't give me that thing. I don't trust my government. I think that thing is poison. I don't know what it's going to do to me. And she's got all kinds of apprehensions. But when Dad sat there and said, well, I'm going to go get it, and then I'm going to go be around people, and her only response was, well, I'll just hide in my house, that doesn't work. So they're both going to end up getting the thing. Meanwhile, Dr. David Beckman joins us on the line. Southsider, check him out. YourFFMG.com. Family First Medical Group. Doc, what do you think when you hear about the apprehension of mom?
I definitely understand the apprehension for getting a vaccine that is developed in record time compared to other vaccines. But you do also have to consider the fact that these vaccines are different than traditional vaccines, whereas most vaccines are either administering an inactive virus or a particle of a virus or using a vector that isn't going to make you sick. Those are kind of the traditional vaccines. But the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines that came out are using technology that has been in place for actually quite a while in terms of treating other diseases using messenger RNA. And so the reason this vaccine was developed so quickly was, number one, we knew the genetic code of the virus very early on, essentially like a month and a half, 2 months after the pandemic began. The entire viral code, genetic code, was known. And so then you could immediately start targeting parts of that virus as a way to get a vaccine. And the mRNA actually takes away a step where you don't actually have to manufacture any protein. You don't have to manufacture any type of antigen, almost like a Snapchat message that you send that tells the cell to make the spike protein. And so you don't have to rely on making an artificial protein. It's actually your own body that is making that protein through these cells. And so that's why this vaccine was able to be developed so quickly, is it's a totally different type of vaccine than anything that we've ever used before.
So it's not as much of it could be corner cutting. It's the way that they made the vaccine and the fact they were able to get the genetic code sooner. That's the quick summation there.
Absolutely. Yeah. You cut out a step in the vaccination process. And not only that, you have the same message that is being absorbed and transcribed by the cells in all of these cells in every case, instead of having to come up with a synthetic version of the virus. This is basically making the same exact protein. The cell is making the same exact protein over and over and over again until that messenger RNA is kind of absorbed and goes away. It makes it easier to develop that vaccine. And what we know is that now, 3 months in, there is not any serious side effect with these vaccines. I know there were reports of these allergic reactions that had occurred in small numbers of people, but I think, you know, this is one of the concerns that has happened through this whole pandemic, which is that everything is talked about in anecdotes. So you hear about the 18-year-old that died from COVID,
right,
and you hear about the four people that got a severe allergic reaction. And then all of a sudden, everyone's like, oh my God, this is terrible. This is deadly. This vaccine isn't going to work.
I've been saying this now forever, that every time, like whenever somebody sits there and says, oh, you better watch out for your kids, and I'll sit there and say, look, you know the names of every kid that's died in the United States because there's an entire article on that kid, because it's like the one kid that died the entire month. Like it's such
right.
a
yep.
rare thing. And that's for
yes.
the same reason that you know the names of anybody that got an allergic reaction, because it's also a very rare thing. But
yes.
that's the problem, isn't it? I mean, the real shame here is the fear and the distrust, the same fear and distrust that has pretty much made this entire country insane. And we just continue to watch these crazy things happen, like the guy with the horns on his head in the Capitol building. Like, I mean, like that's 2020 in a nutshell, and it happened 6 days into 2021. So the insanity didn't end on January 1st. And what you're saying is, don't focus on these outlier things. If you don't want to, if you're the same kind of person that doesn't focus on the outlier thing with the once in a while a young person dies from this, then you can't be the person then that focuses in with laser vision on one person that had an allergic reaction. That the overall numbers show this vast amount of security so far with the vaccine.
Absolutely.
Now, and I say that now, telling you, I don't intend to give this to my kids because they haven't tested it on kids. And I don't feel like with the possibility of them, you know, actually catching it and dying, it's such a rare thing for a child. I'd be like, why would they need it?
Well, Chris, I have to say, I completely agree. I don't plan on vaccinating our children with this vaccine either, for the same reasons that you highlighted. Number one, of course, it's not been studied in patients under 18. But more than that, I think it's that the risk to children under 18 with this virus is incredibly, incredibly low. You really have to, this is a type of infection where you see a clear split in the risk. And starting at age 50, every 10 years older that you are, your risk of getting severely ill increases quite a bit. And so, yeah, using anecdotes is not how you practice medicine, because all of us have encountered tragic situations with children and patients that were healthy that had a horrible outcome or they died, and those memories stick with you. But if you use those experiences to dictate how you practice medicine, then you're going to do a huge disservice to the general public.
That's Dr. David Beckman, Family First Medical Group, the resident physician of Southside Pod. Now that we understand that, let's go get a bite to eat. America's Dog and Burger, now. These guys here sitting with me, I am going to cross my fingers and hope I introduce them properly. We have the two brothers. We have George and Manoli Elpogiannis.
Perfectly said.
I got it.
Perfectly said, and thank you very much, Chris, because you actually had your fingers crossed as you were making that announcement. And you did great. It's been a long time since we've heard it pronounced properly.
I actually had to sit there and go over my head a few times with it before I hit the record button. All right, so you brought out this incredible spread. You guys do basically, you have hot dogs, you have burgers, and then you have sandwiches, wraps, a lot of chicken products and things like that are here. And you know, with the name American Dog and Burger, you pretty much know what this is. But tell me the concept behind this and where it came from.
Well, the whole concept came from, of course, is we're third-generation restaurateurs, and our family was very, very big on road trips. And as, you know, the family, we got older, my brother and I started, you know, going on road trips together. And we noticed as we were driving around the country, different locations, that everybody either dressed or didn't dress a hot dog like we do here in Chicago. And we found it quite interesting. Whether we were directed to a condiment bar that had ketchup, mustard, and onion on it versus, you know, coleslaw being put on hot dogs in the South. And we were just really, really enthralled with the whole concept that, you know, because we're born and raised in Chicago, we knew Chicago hot dogs. There was never ketchup on a hot dog, and it was dragged through the garden, and so we had, you know, all the toppings on there. And we thought that it would be neat to bring these different thoughts and ideas back to the city.
Just talking hot dogs, and we tried a lot of them today. You have the Chicago style, and then you have some's named, I'm just going to give out the names here, the Baltimore, the Santa Fe, the Atlanta, the Dallas. You got a Maxwell Street, you got a Milwaukee, you got the Louisville, which I just love. There are some really interesting concepts here, but what's really neat about it is they're not just all in the same bun. T-
Tell me a little bit about what goes into them, because it's you're using different sauces on different burgers. Everything has its own taste. Everything has its own bun that's specifically made for it. These are more gourmet than just somebody making a hot dog and then going down a line and grabbing, like, I got to get, this condiment, this thing here, and then move on to the next hot dog, right?
Yeah, well, what we felt was we wanted to build these flavor profiles for everybody here. And, you know, there are a lot of great hot dog stands throughout the Chicagoland area. You know, Chicago was all about their neighborhood hot dog stands, which, you know, in part brought us down here to Evergreen Park. But we thought that, you know, we wanted to show off, instead of having just the plain hot dog bun or the poppy seed bun, that we would, you know, build these profiles according to what ingredients are being used, you know, in these regions that we've named the dogs after.
Manoli, you have some interesting sides as well, and the sauces, and you guys seem to really like ghost peppers too. But the thing that I liked about it was the fact that the ghost peppers didn't make me feel like I had to run out of the room screaming or just down my milkshake as quickly as possible. It's adventurous. You don't see this in very many places. Is that the intent, to kind of bring something that people wouldn't see anywhere else?
Yeah. So we wanted to be unique. Like my brother said, there's tons of hot dog stands that are great. There's tons of places to grab a great burger. But really, we wanted to dial up the menu. And I personally love different types of sauces. I love cheese. And so, you know, dipping your tater tots in chipotle aioli, or taking your jalapeno, beer-battered jalapenos, and dipping them in a white cheddar sauce. Those are things that just kind of add on to the flavor a little bit, balancing, you know, if you're taking some beer-battered jalapenos and dipping it in a white cheddar sauce, it kind of cools the palate a little bit and adds another layer of flavor. So, yeah, we definitely, you know, it was totally intentional, and we also kind of cater to what we like as well.
What would you say, don't come to American Dog and Burger without trying this?
You know, the Chicago-style hot dog, of course, is our staple. The Louisville, one of my favorites. I love everything about it. And it's a meal in its own. Nice side dish with it. But we have a nice array of things that will satisfy everyone's needs here, from, you know, our two different styles of chicken salads, as well as, you know, any of the sides that you can mix and match to sort of fill in that area. You know, meals for the kids, and, you know, for God's sakes, you got to have a milkshake to wash it all down.
Yeah, I like the idea that I could get all the flavors, like, stacked. Was that just because I was special, or could somebody else walk in and ask for that?
Well, you are very special, Chris. But we do want everyone to feel that special too. So, yeah, if you ask them for a stacked or a layered milkshake, they can get vanilla, chocolate, strawberry, as well as banana, which is my favorite.
Yeah, I liked them all mixed together too when I was trying this out. Okay, Manoli, what do they get when they come in here?
Hey, look, if you love burgers, you've got to try the bacon cheddar burger. It's a hardwood smoked bacon cooked fresh with a certified black Angus patty. It's a third of a pound. It's on a brioche bun. The cheddar cheese is, you know, outstanding. And the real key to that burger is the AD&B sauce. That secret sauce is really, my brother put it together. I love it. It's a burger that I eat. And a lot like my brother, I eat the Louisville dog all the time. You know, that pretzel roll really, you know, that's what people want. That's now a standard. So I love that.
You know, and I'm a little bit of a snob when it comes to burgers and hot dogs. I really like a burger and a dog with good bread. Nothing's like getting a really nice burger and the bread just falls apart. You have this nice brioche bread on the burgers. And I like with the hot dogs, like you say, you didn't just put everything in a poppy seed bun. You know, you have the toasted brioche, which, you know, like you said, it's a nod to New England with the lobster rolls, and then there's the pretzel roll for the hot dog. So none of it's cookie cutter by any means, and that's what I really like about it.
I'm going to have to roll myself out of here after trying all the food that you guys gave me, but it was incredible. Once again, we have George and Manoli Alpogiannis.
Hey, that's perfect.
You got it. Yeah. There you go.
Thanks, Chris.
Thanks for having
Anna,
us.
Anna, Erica, thanks for joining
thank you.
As well.
Thank you for
we appreciate
us.
All having you guys here at the table with us.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, I'm full.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
so
like, I mean, like, I look, we go do these things and people bring out stuff for us to try. And
Every once in a while, we'll run into a restaurant owner that just wants me to try everything on the menu. These guys wanted to get to try everything on the menu. And you know what? It was all good. That was the thing. Like, I mean, like, you can pick things that you like and things that you, you know, you don't really have. Like, I've never been a Chicago-style hot dog guy. See what I'm saying? Like, I'll eat one every once in a while, but I'm just a guy who just likes to put mustard on his dog. And I when I have, like, one with a poppy seed, that's all I do. But I did try their Chicago-style, and it was good. And now, I need an app. So that's it for Southside Pod for this week. We are back next week. Subscribe, share the show, tell your friends. 30 minutes of good for Southsiders, by Southsiders. Next week, we already know that sitting down here at the bar, Blue Island Beer Company. That's going to be a fun time. We will talk to you soon everywhere podcasts can be found and always at SouthsidePod.com.
Another show is wrapped up. Another show's in the books. Another show is wrapped up. And then by the looks, it's going to be a good one. And we'll see you next week. And the nude is there. Another show is wrapped up, another show is wrapped up, another show is wrapped up, and it's in the books. Another show is wrapped up, another show is wrapped up, and by the looks, it's gonna be a good one. Nudie's Basement, Broadcast Basement, the Nudie's Basement, the Broad Basement.
Slancha. That was like Dropkick Murphys or something, right? I felt like it.